thanks for it. Well, normally we do sermon series here because the truth of it is the topics that we tackle from the pulpit and in the Word typically can't be done in just a one-time deal. And so to properly talk about something, we've talked about the adversary the last 4 weeks, that takes a little time to do that. And so we just break it up and we do a series. I've had this as a, this is what I would call a one-timer. You know, in the music realm, they have, what do they call it, one-hit wonders. So you can classify this as maybe in that category. But and there's no better day for us to have this word than today on a day that we are seeing one of our own go on to their next assignment. And this began to stir in me. Many of you have heard me speak of the Friday morning men's group that I'm a part of, and we've been in Luke. And we were looking at Luke chapter 9, and I was reading that, and then we went to Luke 10, and there was one word that just kept just jumping out of right off the page in Luke 9 and 10. And by the way, we're going to be there for the better part of today, so if you have a Bible, open it up to Luke 9 and 10. We have free Bibles on that table. There's also sermon note pieces of paper and pens that are on that table. But we'll be in Luke 9 and 10 today, and there's this one word that just kept just jumping out, and it was the word sent, S-E-N-T, sent. Couldn't get away from that, and I kept looking. By the way, Luke 9 and 10, what's going on here? Jesus has the 12 apostles, disciples. And he is in a process of, they're in a three-year internship. Jesus' public ministry lasted 3 years, and he called these, said, come follow me, and gathered the 12, and then he poured into them. And it's remarkable that after just 3 years, from that time that the Holy Spirit fell on them in the upper room at Pentecost, that these fishermen, tax collectors, common people then went on to change the world. Let me tell you, if you were going to put a team of people together that were going to do what got done through them, there's no way any of us would have picked the 12 that were picked. I mean, they were just so common. When they stood before the religious elite of Israel, it says that they were perplexed that these men were unschooled, ordinary men from Galilee. Galilee was on the other side of the tracks. It was, and certainly Nazareth. Can anything good come from Nazareth, the Word of God says. And Jesus came from Nazareth. And so they're on this internship, if you will, in Luke 9 and 10. And continually you see Jesus like sending them. Most of us have taken a college class, right? And do we know the difference between the lecture hall and the lab? We know the difference between the lecture hall and the field trip or the assignment where we go out. You see, there's that time when we gather in the lecture hall and the professor's up at the front and he gives out information to the students. But then there comes a time, especially like in a science class or biology, that you got to leave the lecture hall, and you got to go to the lab, and you got to get out the scalpel, and you got to dissect, and you've got to do your practice, and if you're in the medicine, you've got to do calls or go to the doctor's office and see how it is in the real world. You got to test it, and if what you learned in the lecture can't work out there, then something's wrong, and so this is what Jesus did then. And it's what we're doing now. See, this is lecture hall. But what we learn here and what we hear here, if this is all that there is, could you imagine if a doctor, would you want a guy or a woman who's a doctor who had only been to the lecture hall to take a scalpel or a knife to you? I sure wouldn't. I want somebody that not only had the book learning, but then got out there, and while another physician was mentoring and helping and coming alongside of them, learned their craft, learned how to do what they had to do. I wouldn't want somebody that had never done an autopsy where they had opened up and looked at the organs of a body doing a surgery on me. And I don't think I'm any different than you. And so Jesus, he would pour into them and they would have private times. And then of course, you know, also in a college class, there's also these times in many classes where you break down and you're in groups of threes and fours for a project or something of that nature. And see, this is our discipleship. Jesus would take the 12, and sometimes he would take Peter, James, and John. He would just get the three of them, and they would do something. One of those times, by the way, is listed in Luke 9 and 10. In Luke 9, when he takes them up to the mount, and we call this the Mount of Transfiguration, right? Where this divine revelation, and they actually see Jesus transformed. He's in his glorified state, and they're like, you know, speechless at this point, except for Peter. He always has a word, and so he opens his mouth, and we'll take a look at that in a moment. But I say all that to say this. We're going to talk about the word sent today. And it's important that, you know, what does that mean to be sent? Where are we being sent to? What is the cost of being sent? I can tell you right now, there is no value for the believer if the only thing that goes on in your spiritual Christian life is that you come here and it benefits you. I hear people say all the time, it's very common here in media circles. I'll hear people say, well, my faith is a private thing. I'm not going to make that known to everybody. That's just a private thing. It's just between, almost like you're an FBI agent for God. Nowhere in the Word of God do I find anything about this. It's just a private thing. It's for me. And I'm never going to talk about it outside of the walls of my church. The enemy that we've been talking about would love us to contain the good news of what we have right in this little room right here. And so if everybody went into this mantra of, it's a private thing, I'm never going to talk about my faith out there. First of all, we would be in disobedience to the Savior in whose name we bear and who has called us or sent us out from this place into the world. Amen? So praise God for the lecture hall. But brothers and sisters, if you think that this is all that there is, tune in, because there's so much more. Now, there's a lot being said now about walls and walls of division, and then it's all tied into, you know, I mean, we've been bombarded with this topic for the last however long. And I'm not weighing in on the political side of whether or not we should have a wall at the south or of our borders or whatever else. But I want to transfer that argument, that whole discussion, to the spiritual. And by the way, for people, and there have been people that have done this, they've tried to erroneously apply scripture to one thing. And you got to be careful when you do that, because if you're going to do that, make sure you look at the whole scripture and not just the story of your choosing. But just know this, that there are walls that have been mentioned in the Bible that are good walls. There are also walls that need to be destroyed and torn down. On the good wall side, well, when would a wall be good? I go back to, in the Word of God, to an Old Testament book called Nehemiah. And the walls of Jerusalem had crumbled. And Nehemiah was a cupbearer to the king, and many of his people were in exile. And the king loved him and noticed that he was not himself. And he said, "What's wrong, Nehemiah?" And he shared that his homeland, the capital city of Jerusalem, was in ruins, and the walls were all knocked down. And he was given not only permission, but funding from the king to go back and rebuild the walls. Now, why would that wall be good? And by the way, the enemy was there to do everything he could to discourage, to defeat, and to prevent Nehemiah from this goal of erecting and refortifying the walls of Jerusalem. Why did those walls need to be built? Because there were invaders on the outside, and they knew that if Israel got walls again, that meant that their presence was coming. And those walls were there, as with all ancient cities, to keep things out that needed to be kept out. It was their form of protection. And this is right through the Middle Ages, the ancient times, and whatever else, cities had walls. we could translate that. Or are there walls in the life of a believer that are good? Better believe there are. What am I talking about? I'm talking about what we've been talking about the last 4 weeks. There are things that want to make their way into your home. There are things that want to get into your life. And we don't just drop the wall or the bridge over the moat and say to everything, come on in. The enemy is crafty. And he wants to enter in. And we need to have walls, so to speak, on our televisions, decisions that have to be made about just walls. Parents, you know, you love your kids. And you see your son or your daughter hanging with a group or another son or daughter, you don't think, well, those are a whole bunch of bad kids, but Johnny's a Christian, so maybe he'll go save the bunch. You don't have that mindset. No way. Why would you send your child into a group thinking that might be the outcome? If anything, you might let one of them come to your home where you can be a part of the thing and get to know that individual. We don't write anybody off. I mean, Christ died for everybody, but there are some walls, right? Some protections that need to be put up. Where do they need to be put up in your life and mine? You see, only you can answer that, because some of the areas where you need a wall, I don't need a wall there. You know, there are certain things that are not a temptation to me. They're not really a harm to me, so I don't need to put a wall up there. But you know where you need to put up your walls. You know how I know that you know? Because the Holy Spirit is either in you, if you're born again, and even if you're not, Jesus said that the Holy Spirit was being sent into the entire world, and his laws would be written on our hearts. So even for those that are not in Christ, they know. They may not admit that they know, but when they go to bed at night, there are certain things that they know are right, certain things they know are wrong. And so some walls are good. We do that. But you know, there's other walls that need to be broken down. As believers, and this is in keeping with this message today, we're called to build bridges and to be sent. As I look at these two chapters, Luke 9 and Luke 10, and referencing that passage that I've already talked about where Jesus takes Peter, James, and John and they leave the lecture lab and they go on a little field trip and he says, I want to show you something. And boy, did he ever. And here's Moses, here's Elijah, and of course they've since died and gone. And here they are in this glorified state and stammering. Peter gets this idea. Remember it? You know, Peter's a hands-on guy. He's a fisherman. He builds things. He's uneducated. But he would have fit in at Gander Mountain. That's just Peter. He would have been really good there. He could have helped at Lowe's. You name it. Peter would have been good. And he says, Lord, why don't we build a shelter here? I can build a shelter for you. And one for you, one for James, John. We'll build a shelter and we'll just stay up here on this mountain. And it'll be awesome. And God the Father says, this is my son in whom I am well pleased. Listen to him! Exclamation point. In other words, Peter, be quiet. Just stay in the moment here with us. And then it says they came down from the mountain. You know, there's more in that story that we can relate with than we probably are willing to admit. As believers, man, when I'm with my brothers and sisters, and it's good, and I'm not dealing with the people on the outside. Oh, that feels good. I draw strength from you to be have my hands laid on by my brothers and sisters and prayed and strengthened in the word. And it's just good. And sometimes I just want to build things where we can all come on in and just wall out everything on the outside. You know, we're striving, are we not, to have a permanent structure for this fellowship. Permanent home. And we need that. But can we just break down just for a moment why we need that and why we don't need that? Our motive of building that is not so we can build something for us where we can come on in and just be us. I was talking to our greeters. We've got awesome greeters at this church. And we've gotten feedback to that effect as well. But I read something this past week where they said the worst thing that greeters can do, because when people visit, they make assessments in the first 5 minutes of a visit. They kind of size the church up. They do that. And what they said, one of the worst things that can ever happen is when a visitor comes in, the greeters are all kind of huddled up, you know, just kind of loving on each other, feeling the love and whatever, and oblivious to the fact that new people are coming in. And the greeters are just all like that. Why is that? Because walls, maybe unintended. But when we have a mindset of this is ups, we're going to come in, we're going to hunker down, we're going to circle the wagons, it's a big, bad, nasty world out there, so we need to just come on in and we build the walls and keep everybody out. That's not what we are. Jesus' final words in the Great Commission, you remember what he said? He said, go. Go. Go where? There's a lot of places, we'll talk about that, but go. He didn't say stay. The only thing he did tell his followers, 120 of them, I believe, at the time, he said, I want you to go to this room in Jerusalem upstairs, and you wait. He does say wait sometimes. But he says, you wait for the Holy Spirit. You wait for my lead. But when that comes, you're out of here. You go and you do what you are led to do. You know, that Spirit has come. And I think we do need to wait on the Lord for directives sometimes. I don't think we want to just be marching around doing whatever is the first impulse. Bad things happen when we just act on first-time impulses. Spiritual wisdom says that there's discernment. We wait on the Lord. We seek his counsel. We say, Lord, I don't know what to do. I got a big decision to make. I don't know what to do. I need you to give me some guidance and some direction. But when you finally have an idea, and maybe it's just nothing more than you're like, well, all right, this is the door that's open, then it's time that you go. And we're being sent. And so the Lord that we serve has called us, friends, to build spiritual bridges, not to erect walls between ourselves and the world around us. And you know what? Sometimes that's going to get uncomfortable and messy. You know, as believers, there are certain things that are on the outside that we're not comfortable with. There's views, there's habits, there's practices that are very common outside of the walls of the church. Now, when I go, do I involve myself in practices that are not of God so that I can relate to the lost? Heavens, no. Why would you do that? Why would you take your light and go out into a dark world only to snuff out the light so that you can now be dark relating to dark? No, the light goes into the darkness. It pierces the darkness. And what's the spirit in which we do that? We do it with truth and love. It's grace that we do. We don't do it with an attitude of I'm better than you and I'm going to come and fix all, you know, I'm going to show you how it is or how this all works. That's not the spirit in which we go. We go as one who has been in no less darkness than the people that we seek to take the light to. We go because we know that when light came into darkness, what it did for us. And we go, sometimes there are times we don't say anything. Amen? We just go and we do what we do and we do the right things and we trust that light will shine in dark places wherever it goes. Two key verses, and then we're going to just take a look at a few of these things from Luke 9 and 10. And I guess as we're processing this and going through it, I just want you to be asking yourself, where am I being sent to? You know, like today is a unique day because we've got Enosh and Tiffany. And when we say they're being sent, we don't imply that Orchard Ridge is the one sending them. Our job is to release them with grace and with blessing. We release them. But the one sending them is God. God sends people. You know, I think it's a layer of arrogance to think that a church is the one manipulating these moves. It's, you know, God sends, and we release. Not all of us when we talk about being sent, are sent to necessarily leave a geography. That's only one form of being sent. Let's take a look at these verses and we'll continue on. Please be asking yourself, though, as I'm preaching, and my prayer for you that I've already prayed is just, Lord, where would you be sending me? Where would you be sending me? Isaiah 6:8, this is in the Old Testament. And then I, meaning Isaiah, heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? And who will go for us? Now, we did a lot of time, did we not, talking about the Trinity? The Trinity is right here in everything I just said. Take a look at that. Whom shall I, singular God, one God, whom shall I send? And who will go for, plural, us? You have one God in three persons. Whom will I send and who will go for us? And then Isaiah says, here am I, send me. It's been said, and rightly so, that your number one attribute, the thing that you have to offer God more than you have anything else to offer God, is your availability. It's not your ability. And which is good if you're a person that says, well, I don't have any gifts, or what do I have to offer that God can use? There's nothing there. And he says over and over again, I do my best work with cracked pots. I do my best work with messed up people. And when I use messed up people and cracked pots, the world around is baffled because it says, how could this result have come from somebody of so that was so unqualified? And so our untalent, if you will, or the lack of talent can never be an excuse, because God says your greatest ability is your availability. And be able to say, here I am, Lord, send me. Use me. And by the way, this isn't always about big life decisions like this couple has had to make. This is a prayer all of us should be praying every morning. Lord, send me today. You know, give me an awareness to know when I'm checking out at the grocery line that maybe there's somebody there that might need a smile, or they might need just something that I can be used as a conduit of you. And so there's that. And then we go to John 20, verse 21. And this is after Jesus is, he's risen from the dead and he's in his glorified state and he's giving some final, he's just restored, I believe, Peter. And it says in verse 21, and Jesus said, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you. You realize, don't you, that the first one who was sent and gives us this example of being sent was Jesus himself. Jesus was sent from heaven on earth down to us. And can I just suggest to you for a second, if Jesus had been born into a palace home with all of the benefits, the most luxurious setting human beings can be brought into. If that had been the case, do you realize what even then, what a downgrade it would have been from the Son of God to leave heaven to come here? Even if it had been palatial, it would have been an extraordinary sacrifice to come here. And yet, he didn't come in that context, did he? He came and humbled himself to be born of a very common family, and most scholars believe in a cave. That stable was in a cave on the side of a hill where they kept the animals. That was their stables. In just meager, humble means, he clothed himself with humanity, and he came. Now, if the Lord was sent to that environment and those means, what does that mean for me? Is the student any greater than the teacher? I might be getting sent into some situations. I know many of you have been sent. If I can just unpack this a little bit, there was a couple of examples that came to my mind. One is Jerry Barkey, who happens to be my father. It's not why I'm sharing this story with you, but you know, my dad retired after, was it 38 years at GM? 40? That's a long time. Ooh, 40 years at GM, retired, and they came up with a program whereby the retirees, that you used to work with can now go to places and mentor youth in disadvantaged areas, and you come alongside of them. And he's given a very small financial stipend, but it's not enough to justify doing it. But you do it out of the goodness of your heart, you know, if you want to do that. And so he got a part of that. And you know my dad, he's good with his hands, built this pulpit, all these prayer altars. He built all of that, all these carts that roll our stuff around. He did that in his workshop. He took those skills, and is it Romulus? What's the name of the community? I'm saying Romulus, but I don't know. River Rouge. Yeah, so he was down in River Rouge. And this student body just kind of came attached to him. Strong father figure. It's not the best economic area. He was the minority in this setting, to say it that way. And went down there, and just the kids really attached themselves to him. And you were at River Rouge for how many years? Couple? Huh? 3 years. And so there was succession, and students knew him and all the rest of it. Oh, one thing that they did is they prayed. He started praying before they'd eat lunch. And they rebuilt lockers. He did all kinds of stuff. He did building. They prayed before lunch. Well, one of his coworkers came alongside and said, Jerry, I don't think we should be praying with the kids, you know, church and state. And I don't know if GM would like us praying with the kids. And I think the Holy Spirit guided him, and he said, all right. He said, we'll hold off on that, and let's just see what the kids. And so, you know what, the next lunch, he didn't pray. They brought the lunch out, he didn't pray. You know what the kids said? Hey, Mr. Jerry. They made all the other kids stop. And they said, Mr. Jerry, you got to pray. We're not going to eat before you pray. That's what the kids wanted. And if you know anything about the law, the kids in the schools have the rights. We don't have the rights. The teachers don't have the rights. But the kids have the rights. And the kids said, we're going to pray. And that's how that got shut down. How did that happen? It's because he was sent. You know, it could have been, and again, I'm not judging anybody and how we all have things to do. But he could have adopted the mindset of, I'm retired now. I'm done. I'm done with giving. I'm going to travel. It's all I'm going to do. It's going to be about me, finally. That's how it's going to go. I'm retired. But an opportunity came. And when you got the Spirit of Christ in you, you listen. Now, for some person, maybe the Lord wasn't sending them to River Rouge, and they said no, and that's fine. Because there is no universal answer here for how this works. But in his case, he was called. And it resonated. How do you know if you're called? You can't get it out of your head. It gnaws at you. You see a need, and you're like, man, somebody should do something about that, and you just keep on going. That just bugs me. Somebody should be doing something about that. And then one day, maybe you wake up and you realize that's why he created you. And that's why he put that burden on your heart. And that's why it's gnawing at you. Because he does want to do something about it. He wants you to do something about it. And so he went. And he was sent. And good things came out of that. Now this year, he's going to be in a different community and all the rest. But awesome. And then recently, and I have to be careful how I say this, because the individual's very health could be in jeopardy. But I was challenged. Because, you know, in America, we don't... How many people do you know that live in the U.S. who put their lives on the line as potential martyrs because of what they're doing? They might be killed for that thing. I met one maybe for the very first time this past recently. I'm just going to be very ambiguous about this. But I met an individual, I'll call him Mike. And God has given him a very unique passion to reach the Muslim community for Christ. You know, most Christians don't even know that Muslims hold Jesus in very high esteem. Now, we have differences on what Jesus is and what his role was and who he was, and all those other things are different, but Jesus is cool to the Muslims. And this Mike just felt this burden that he needed to go to that community. Let me ask you a question. You know, traditionally, how do we do missions? We train up somebody stateside. We try to teach them a little of the language and the culture, and then we ship them off to the foreign field, and then they try to meet people. And there's nothing wrong with that. That's one way of doing it. But friends, in America, what do you do when the other nations come and they move in next door to you? God help us if our whole mindset, you know, the dynamics of even my own neighborhood, they're changing, and people are moving in. And I can look at that if I want to with eyes of what's going on in the neighborhood, or, wow, the Lord is bringing the nations to my footstep, to my doorstep. Wow, people that Jesus loves and died for are moving in right next to me, and they might not even know him. Or, check this out, they might know him more than you do, and they want to impart something good to you. And so we got to sift through the nonsense of all of that. And this individual felt this conviction to reach this community. One of the things he did is he moved in to Dearborn. If you know the Dearborn, there are more Middle Eastern Muslims in metropolitan Detroit than anywhere else in the world outside of the Middle East. Most of the people that are in America, we've adopted, we've seen all that we've seen on the media. We've automatically, everybody's got a headband or whatever, a turban, they're part of ISIS, and we just want to keep our, we build our walls. The walls are coming up all over the place. And this guy's like, no way. The Lord has called me to build a bridge, not a wall. And so he moves in to Dearborn, starts building relationship and friendship on the university campus in Detroit. Goes so far as to attend a mosque service. Their day is Friday. You know, our day is Sunday. The Jews have Saturday. I mean, so he goes on the Friday and he attends the service and whatnot. And he asks the imam, he says, would it be all right if I asked a question to your congregants or whatever you would call them? And he says, sure, go ahead. And then he poses this question. He said, if you could ask one or more questions to a devout Christian, what would those be? Would you be willing to give those questions to me? If you could ask a question, any question, to a devout Christian about our Christian views, what would those be? And he got over five different mosques. They gave him a lot of cards with questions, a lot of cards. Can I just share one of the stats that I was given that this blew me away? More Muslims have come to Christ in the last 10 years than all the other 14 centuries combined. Since 2007, more Muslims have come to Jesus than when this whole thing started, when Muhammad lived in the year 600, you know, forward. Wow. But here's another stat. More Muslims are leaving Islam, typically second generation in the United States. They're getting into the Quran, they're reading it, they're watching the world scene. More of them are leaving Islam than are becoming Christians or converting to Christianity. They're just saying, if this is God, I just don't want anything to do with any of it. And they're just walking away from the whole thing. And to this he has been called in. You know what he did? He took those questions and he's writing a book. It's going to be out soon. I want this individual to come speak at our church. When we do that, we won't be filming. It'll be just a closed session. We will put up a wall for his protection on that day. And why do I say for his protection? When I was in this discussion with him and some other ministers, one of them said, they asked about the book, where this book is all about the questions, the top questions that if a Muslim could ask a devout Christian, this is what they would ask. He took all those questions and he's writing a book, and he has the education to do it and to do it well, and God has called him. God has sent him, amen, to do it. And he's doing it, and somebody asked the question, are you a little worried? Are you going to put your name on the book, is what they asked. And right then it hit me. First I thought, why is he asking a question like that? Oh, is he going to put his name on the book? If you're a devout Muslim, and if the answers in that book in any way are seen as degrading to the Quran or to their prophet, it can be this. For the glory of God, it can be this. And we asked him, are you worried about that? He said, I think about it. I think about it. Is he going to write the book? You bet he's going to write the book. I think, wow. And I was stuck there, and I was like, what'd I do? Like, we read about this stuff in our books. We read about people going and laying their life on the line. And here it was in the United States of America, this guy motivated by love because he's been sent of God to do a thing. And love is motivating him, the love of Christ, to go into this community and to write this book, not to say we're right and you're wrong. That's not the motivation. But it's to start at the place of their belief and then have the discussion. And look, the truth always prevails. The truth is the truth. I mean, listen, if our truth isn't truth, then show me the truth and then let our truth go away. But the truth will always stand. And I say that to say, those are just two small examples of how we are sent. You may say, I'm on lockdown. I'm a mother with small children, or we've got a young family. Listen, there will always be times in your life that you cannot get up and go and do some elaborate mission or whatever else. Or there are seasons. But do you know this? In every season of life, and I don't care what season it is, there are opportunities for you to be sent. Sometimes you're sent to take a meal, as many of you have done, to somebody in need. You've been sent. Some of you have been sent to write a card. And maybe sent means taking that card to the post office, slapping on the stamp and dropping it in the box. But make no mistake about it, my brothers and sisters, we have all been sent. And what we don't want to ever be is the people who stay, the people who remain, the people who have the truth and have walled off the world around us. The Lord says, who will go for us? Whom shall I send? And I hope that our answer would be, Lord, here am I, send me. Because we are a sent people. We don't have time. That's all I can tell you is that go read 9 and 10 of Luke. And the word sent, 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 it is all over the place in that chapter. And where have we been sent to go? In closing, in Acts 1:8, it says, tells us that Jerusalem, Samaria, Judea, in the uttermost parts of the world. What are those areas? To the Jew, Jerusalem was home. We're sent to your next door neighbor. You're sent to your next door neighbor. Yeah, even the difficult ones, the ones that just really, you want to put a wall of arborvitae between the two of you. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, you're sent there somehow. And if not, you say, why, Lord? Why did you put them next to me? Why not you? Why not you? We're a sent people. What can you do to bring peace to that situation? Blessed are the peacemakers, right? So Jerusalem, Judea. Judea is my region. It's this area around me that I live. And so I'm sensitive to the needs that are in my area, Michigan, Macomb County, the area. And then there's Samaria. And for Jews, he said, you're being sent to Samaria. So yeah, you're being sent to the inner city. You're being sent to those communities that are of ethnicities that make you very uneasy. You're being sent there. We're being sent to the prisons. We're being sent to places that make us really uncomfortable. That's Samaria. And we are being sent to the uttermost parts of the world. And let me tell you, every time you put a dollar in that plate, a portion of that, specifically 5.5 cents, a nickel and a half, is going out to the world. and it's supporting missionaries that are out there on the foreign field. And we twice a year, we bring them in here and give you an opportunity to hear what they have to say. We had a wonderful time with the missionaries from Thailand and heard their story. They're a sent people. This is my final thought, and I'm done. One day, we're going to look at our Creator. And He's going to say, George, I sent you. We're either going to say, hem haw around for some kind of an answer, or we're going to say, I know I was sent, and by the grace of God, I went. I went. And He will say, well done, my good and faithful servant. Because you have been faithful in small things, I'm now going to give you much more. And unfortunately, that won't be the story of many. And He says He will take away from the one who didn't go and give it to the one who went. We just have to ask the question, where am I being sent? You know, some of our people have been sent to Ann Arbor. Got Mary Rose sent to Ann Arbor. Zach's being sent to Ann Arbor. There's one more that I'm trying to think. I think we have like three now that are, I can't remember who the third one is. But God's doing something there. And they might think that was all about them and whatever else. No, you apply and you get accepted or you don't get accepted. And if you're in Christ and you get accepted, there's a reason that you're there beyond getting a great education. You're there because light needs to go to that place. And it needs to go to East Lansing. And it needs to go to Macomb Community College. And it needs to go to Wayne State. The light of the world needs to go. So where you are, even in the job you're in, Enosh is so happy he doesn't have to go to the printing shop anymore. But for a season, he was sent there. And while he was there, he touched a lot of lives. There were a lot of people he had to go on the road and talk about jobs and whatever else. He never said, by the way, that it was going to be easy when we'd get sent. But this is what he did say. He got them together, two by twos. That's why our picture had the two people standing there. He got them together and he said, I'm sending you. And he said, as you go, only take your staff. Don't take purse. Don't take anything. I'm going to provide for you when you go. I'm going to provide for you. Let me just say something about Chad. And he may not like this. I don't know. I want to say it anyway. If you liked Chad this morning, that's wonderful. And we'll enjoy Chad for 2 months. And the reason we're only going to enjoy Chad and his lovely wife, Rhea, and their little baby, Milo, we're going to get to know them and love them here for 2 months. But I met with Chad and just seeing what God was doing in his life and explaining to him our situation of transition. And, he met with me. They came and worshiped with us on a Sunday. And then later that night, I was coming home from Cincinnati, took my daughter back to college. And then I called him and we talked and he was very honest and he said, Pastor, I know I told you when we met for lunch, the Lord's called me to start a church and we're gonna start a meeting in my basement. I'm like, oh, that's a novel idea. I've heard that before, eh, Kelly? Yeah, that's how we started out. So I'm just resonating with this story. This is good. He's like, yeah, God's called me to start a church. And his conviction, and again, this isn't to say that this has to be the case for every minister, but right now, where he's at in his walk, he said, the only thing I can tell you is the Lord's told me I can't accept any money for whatever I do to help you. I can't accept it because I have a good job, and my wife has a good job, and we have enough, and so I can't take any money from Kingdom Resources to just get me more. I just need to do it, and I got to tell you, 47 years old, I'm looking across the table and I'm like, felt like somebody just punched me in the gut. Like, that was a gut check to ask the question. But it was right in keeping with what the Lord said. When you go out, don't take anything with you. Don't worry about that. Why? It's because He would provide. Later on, just a few chapters later, when they were all at the end of their 3-year internship, He referenced this sending out of the twos, and he says, do you remember when I sent you out two by two, and I told you not to take anything? And they said, yeah, we remember. And then he asked him this question. He said, did you lack anything? And they said, no, we didn't lack anything. We're sending, releasing, the Lord has sent them, we're releasing these two. But in 2 months, we'll be releasing Chad and his family to this new work that I think is going to be in Rochester, correct? And I'm just going to tell you all right now, listen to me. I am praying that over the next 2 months, as Chad is leading worship, I want you to be in prayer that if God would be calling you to be sent from this place to come alongside of that couple for a year, maybe 2 years, to lend support, help, maybe forever, whatever, I want you to consider that. And I want you to know that this church is a sending church. We will send, send. Because when you scatter the seed, the harvest is greater. And when you let it go, the Lord brings it back. And so I don't just say this out of I'm just giving it lip service. I mean it with all my heart. If God's calling you to leave here to help out a young man and a young woman, I wish somebody had done that for me when we got started. But the Lord provides. We lacked for nothing. He gave us what we needed, and it came in. And so we're continually sending, and it's going to be good. And so we're going to go to prayer right now. And I want Enosh and Tiffany, if you would kneel here, we're going to have as many of you as you can come. And there will be a time will come in a couple of months that we will have Chad and Rhea come kneel, and we will send you when you're done with this brief time with us. But I'm asking all of us, if we can just dim the lights and bring that down a little bit. God's talking here, isn't he? Is he not talking to you? Listen, if you're just sitting there listening to what I'm saying, we've missed the mark. Then I've done a horrible job of preaching today. We should be hearing and asking that question, Lord, I can't do this. I can't go there because there's things I got to do. And you know that. Those are God-ordained obligations. But I have been really had a mindset of walls. I've been building up the walls and just filling myself with, you know, the Dead Sea, don't you? Has no fish in it in Israel. No fish in the Dead Sea. You want to know why? Because it's got no release valve. The sea, the River Jordan comes in from the mountains to the north, and it goes into the Sea of Galilee. Sea of Galilee teeming with fish and wildlife and all kinds of cool stuff. Then it drains out, and the River Jordan goes all the way down into the Dead Sea. The Dead Sea receives, but it doesn't give. You know what that leads to? Death. It's a dead lake. And if your life is sitting in church, going to the Bible studies, receive, 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 and you've got no outlet, no place to give it out, you're not going to team with the abundant life that God has for you. Figure it out, brothers and sisters. I don't care if you're in a wheelchair and bedridden, whatever. Somehow you're being sent. You might be sent to your prayer closet to go pray, but you're sent. We're all sent. All right. Let's do some business with God and line these altars up and down and gather around this couple. And when we leave out of here today, let's go a sent people with a mission and a purpose. Amen.